This is Rhetoric 3, Apologetics class at St. Stephen's Academy. And we have been interacting on different questions concerning not only the person of God and the identity of Jesus, but also interacting on different questions that would help us come into conversations with friends and people that we would encounter that would aid us on getting down to ultimate questions and spiritual matters. And so we've invited this morning Bernie Dehler to come in as a secular humanist and to field the question, who is Jesus? And we're going to listen to his 5-minute response to that, mas o menos, and then we will ask him questions or make comments and get the discussion going. So we've chosen for Christian apologetics, we've chosen a fairly bedrock, mainstream, central question to ask just to get the conversation going. So thank you for coming, Bernie.
Okay.
I would imagine you had something else to do today, like
yes.
Go to work.
Yes.
So you adjusted your schedule.
Right.
That's very kind of you, because yes. it really does help our class to have you do this. So
okay.
Once again, thank you.
All right, thanks. Okay, I have a handout here for people. If you could take one of these and pass them around. To start off, I may take 10 minutes, 5 or 10 minutes, just to give you a brief overview. To start off, let me ask you a question. Does anybody in here, can you name some of the Greek and Roman gods that people believed in during the Roman Empire time? Do you guys know any? Yeah.
Jupiter, Venus, Saturn,
can you say it louder?
Jupiter, Venus, Hera, Hercules, Hephaestus.
Mm-hmm. Does anybody else know any other ones? Or how about Egyptian gods? Have you heard of any of those?
Ra.
Isis. Yeah, so at one time people really believed in these gods, right? So imagine today if, I heard even some people in other countries still believe in Zeus even, because they have some temples still for Zeus, and they want to, you know, keep the tradition alive, and so they still want to like revive that. So, but just imagine today though, if people still believed in Zeus, and somebody invited you as a Christian to come into their room and say, we want you to talk to your kids, to our kids about who is Zeus? You know, is he Lord, legend, or liar, or what? You know, what do you do with that? So in your mind, you know Zeus is not a real god, right? So you're going to try to explain to them in a nice way and everything. So anyway, that's the situation that I'm in, is that, you know, how you guys don't believe in Zeus and all these other gods, that's the way I am now, is I don't believe in God. So, you know, that's what I'm trying to impart to you, is I'm trying to, you know, so I want to do this for the sake of education, so, you know, we can have intellectual discussion. And, you know, a lot of people don't talk about this, and so I want to, you know, say that you really have a special pastor here to allow somebody in like this. And so let me introduce the idea of a trilemma. It means like you have maybe have three difficult choices to make, and this is going to come up later, this trilemma idea. But here's an idea on censorship about trilemma. It says in society, for example, you can censor speech. And what would be the three possible outcomes of that? One is that the person had the truth, and you silenced the truth, so you hurt the society by not being able to hear the truth. Or the guy could have been a liar or having not truth, and so then what happened there is that you neglected the chance for teaching the truth by showing how other things are not true. And the third possibility is that you suppressed something that was half truth and half not truth. And if that was the case, then basically there could have been elements of truth that would have been good to highlight. Okay, so what I'm saying is it's good to not censor things and to get it out in the open, because a lot of pastors actually complain, or even parents, that their kids leave the faith when they go to college. And so what Pastor Nathan is doing is trying to inoculate you by heading that off and saying, let's look at the arguments and let's talk about it. So it's very smart, and it's also very rare. So that's why I'm saying it's a really good idea that we're having this kind of a talk. And I do the same thing with my kids. I don't believe in God, but I teach them about religion. I teach them about the different beliefs too. So they don't hear it from some kind of strong follower of Islam or Mormonism or something. I want them to be exposed before they actually meet a fervent believer in it. So here's the main categories of this topic. Who is Jesus, liar, Lord, or lunatic, liar, or Lord, or another one is legend, which isn't talked about very much. So first of all, I have a whole bunch of points. One point is that the trilemma setup is false. It's not like it could be just one thing. It could be a mixture of them. For example, he could be a little bit of a liar or a little bit crazy. So it doesn't have to be just all, he's all super crazy or all super liar. And this is kind of how C.S. Lewis phrased that. He says, you know, that, you know, if he was a liar, he's like the devil of hell, you know, and if he was crazy, he's like a lunatic who says he's like a poached egg. So you don't have to go to that extreme. It could be just a little mixture of each. Another thing I want to say is there's evidence that Bible stories aren't reliable, because a lot of people say, like, well, look at the Bible. And some examples of that is, I would say, like in Matthew 27:52, it talks about when Jesus died, the tombs opened up and these dead people walked around and gave witness to Jesus. And so some theologians say, like, well, that's obviously was tucked in there because it doesn't really make sense when you try to figure out what happened there. And another one is where it's, you know, it says that if you're a believer and you drink poison, it won't kill you. Well, you obviously know if you're a Christian and somebody makes you drink poison, you're going to die. You're probably not going to get saved from that. And another one I would add too is in Acts, it says Jesus arose into heaven, ascended into heaven. Well, in those days, they thought heaven was up there. So when they wrote the story, they said God went to heaven. But nowadays, if you're going to make up a story about God going into heaven, you wouldn't say that, because you would say heaven's in another dimension. You wouldn't say heaven's up there. Why is that? Well, because we have spaceships that are way past there. We know there's no heaven up there. But the ancients who wrote the Bible and first read it, they believed heaven literally was up there. So that's why they wrote the story that way. I think most likely Jesus is probably mostly legend, so there could have been a real person that existed and they just blew the story around him. Just like today in Mormonism, there's people who believe in Joseph Smith, and when you talk to Mormons about Joseph Smith, they're very emotional about it, but might even cry. They love him so much because of what he did. He gave the truth, but because it wasn't that long ago, he's easy to disqualify, because we know he had like false translations of the Book of Abraham, which turned out to be an Egyptian writing. It's an ancient Egyptian burial text, but he says, oh no, this is a book that Abraham wrote. It's like, we can tell, we know today, because we know we can read Egyptian, it's a faulty translation. But in his day, they didn't really know how to translate that well, so he got away with it for a little bit. And then each Christian sect has a little bit of a different Jesus. Like in the Catholics, they believe that the wafer turns into the literal body and blood of Jesus, even though you don't see it. It literally is Jesus. So when you receive Jesus, eating the bread, they call that receiving Jesus when you take communion. And then the Protestants, of course, have a different idea. And the Mormons say that, you know, they have a different Jesus too. Their Jesus is like the brother of Satan and all of us in the spiritual world before we came and got our body. And the Muslims believe in Jesus too, but he's a prophet. So there's all kinds of different Jesuses that people have created. And some people might say, well, I have feelings about Jesus. I know Jesus is alive and God's alive because I feel it. I say, well, there's a lot of people believe things that you think are wrong, but they also feel it. Like Mormons say they prayed to God for evidence of the Book of Mormon, and they got a burning in the bosom to validate it. And also, like Native North Americans, they might say they have relationships with the trees and rocks. The trees and rocks have spirits, and you know, everything's spiritual, and we feel it. But you guys don't believe there's spirits in the trees and rocks, for example. But so that just shows how feelings can be misapplied. And even as a Christian evangelist, you say, sometimes they warn you not to depend on feelings too much, because if you got the flu, you're going to feel sick. And they're going to say, just because you feel sick doesn't mean you're not close to Jesus. You're still close to Jesus, so don't let the feelings confuse you with your relationship with God. But yet they don't say the opposite. When somebody goes around saying, oh, I feel like a spiritual high, I feel so close to Jesus, they won't say it then. Like, oh, well, don't, just because you feel good, don't mess that up with your relationship idea, you know. They only use it on the negative side, you know, don't let it distract you. But if you have positive feelings, oh good, you know, that's evidence for God, you know. So it's not being fair on the feelings. And then So you got to watch out for people. There's a lot of people who are just faking things in the name of Jesus, for example, or Peter Popoff is a faith healer who is exposed on TV by having a hearing aid, and they tell him things in the audience. Like, there's somebody here named Mary. Yeah. Oh, her, and you got a hearing problem. Yeah, how'd you know that? Your address is so-and-so. How'd you know that? Well, it turns out somebody was telling him, and he had this hearing aid planted into him so that they can tell him electronically what was in the audience, and he got busted for that. But he's still on TV, and Benny Hinn, most people think he's probably, a fake healer. And then you got false prophets too, like Harold Camping, who twice last year, you probably heard about him, talk about that Jesus is gonna return by certain dates twice, and now he's saying, well, I'm not gonna do that anymore, I learned my lesson, And then one final thing, well, a couple final things, I guess, is one is some people say Jesus didn't claim to be God. There's one passage just in history, there was church councils over this, and there was big debates. And, and in fact, the church in power would kill people as heretics if they didn't believe this. But nowadays, I mean, Christianity's been sorted out because it's been so many hundreds of years later that nowadays, you guys, it's like, of course there's a Trinity. But there was a time in the church history when the church debated these things very vigorously. And for example, in Mark 2, you guys know the story about Jesus healed a paralytic, and Jesus said, forgive your sins. And then they said, who do you think you are, God? And Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man in that passage. And I looked up at the Son of Man in the Bible, and I saw some places in the Old Testament, like Numbers 23, where it says God is not a son of man. And Ezekiel 2:3, Ezekiel is called the son of man. So the son of man is put to Ezekiel. And Daniel's called the son of man in Daniel. So you can say Jesus, when he's saying, I'm the son of man, you can see that he could possibly be saying that he's the same prophet like Ezekiel or Daniel. People would point out there's nowhere where Jesus, just is straight up and says, hey, I'm God. Look, people, I'm God. Even when he says, I am in the Father and the Father is in me, he talks about the same with you, like, I'll be in you and you can be in me. So it's like, well, you're not God. So it's, you gotta watch all the parallels. So just one final note, I want to talk about secular humanism just very briefly. My definition on your handout here is secular humanism is a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by using modern science and reason. So I think a Christian could agree with all of this except for the naturalistic belief part. And the reason why I would say it's naturalistic is because there's no evidence for anything supernatural. And two things to back that up. One is, the most important one is this guy named the amazing James Randi. He has a James Randi Foundation. And he says, if you can prove anything supernatural, you get $1 million. And he's had this out there for many times. So these psychics who put these fortunes out, these people who do cold readings, which means they say, there's a spirit in here, and he wants to talk to people, All these people have been put to the test. Some of them refuse to be tested, but he's disqualified these people under scientific tests. So like anybody who has any kind of supernatural claim, you can say, oh, if you want $1 million, just prove it, So it's kind of funny to hear the excuses people have, like, oh, I don't have time for that test. And it's like, we don't have time, but you get on the telephone and you do psychic readings for people, How many psychic readings would it take to make $1 million? It's a $3 million that would prove it, you could do it. So, that's it. So anyway, I welcome your questions. Ask me the hardest questions you can, don't worry about it. And I take this purely as an intellectual, educational thing. And so I'm not gonna get offended, and I appreciate you guys for considering the same thing. I know these are very important subjects that go straight to your heart and they affect your whole worldview and how you see yourself in the world and with God and all that stuff. So it could be really emotional, but so I appreciate you guys thinking about this and putting emotion to the side for a little bit and just thinking of things critically and asking questions. So, any questions? I know you like to ask questions because I remember you and I'm not sure if that. And you ask some questions, I think, sometimes. I'm not sure if I recognize anybody else. So you got a good one.
Oh, no, it's not a very good question, but I was wondering exactly what your view of Christ is, because you talked a lot about how the Mormons view him and how other Christians view him, but exactly what is your take on who he is.
Yeah, so I think there is probably a Jesus that lived. They said in that time there's a whole bunch of false messiahs, a whole bunch of people that claimed to be the Messiah, because what happened was Israel was under the control of the Roman Empire, and they wanted to get their freedom. They wanted to be independent, just like now we're occupying Iraq and these other countries, and they say, get the Americans out of here. Well, it's the same way the Jews. They want to get the Romans out of Israel. And so who's going to save us from this? Well, this is the Messiah. So they're always looking for messiahs, and some of them were militant. Some people think Jesus was a militant one. So I think he was probably one of these guys. And then, like I said, after he died, they built the legend about him. So, for example, the Apostle Paul wrote that, like over 500 people saw him at one time. It's like, who are these people? And sometimes preachers say, like, well, you know, it was very gutsy of him to write that because people could have checked. Well, how could you have checked? And especially if he wrote it like 30 years after Jesus, died or sometime, it's like, okay, well, supposedly 500 people saw him 30 years ago.
So you believe that he came, and his purpose in coming was to deliver the Jews, and that people kind of exaggerated that and blew that up?
No, so I think he was just a person, like a lot of people. There was a lot of messiahs. They all had their own disciples, just like now in India, you can find gurus that have disciples around them. So Jesus had disciples around him, and he traveled. He was a preacher, and he was probably preaching the end of the world is going to come soon, like a lot of preachers even today. And he had his disciples, and...
How accurate do you think the scriptural accounts of Jesus are?
Probably very not at all, almost. I think somebody wrote those stories probably way after. I mean, who knows? You don't have any of the original manuscripts. A lot of these, they're not even sure. The scholars, when was it written? The scholars are trying to place a date on these, and some, like Revelation, was that actually written after the temple was destroyed or before? Maybe it could have been written afterwards, but they made it sound like, like I could write a story right now about everything and say, oh, look at this book I just found. It's 1,000 years old, But just because I say it doesn't mean it was written. And so like Revelation is a certain book written in it's called apocalyptic genre. It's a certain kind of genre. And there was a whole bunch of these out there. And so they decided to put this one in the canon of the Bible. And it was like the last one that he put in there. I think it was like the year 270 AD or something. So that wasn't even in the Bible until that time. So beforehand, Christians would argue about whether that's even scripture or not. So the Bible gradually arose through church councils about which books to put in or not.
So would you say that Christianity is the most successful, greatest legend of all time?
Well, see, that's kind of a funny question, because it's like, which Christianity? Because, like the Catholic, like you don't believe in a Catholic Christianity.
Just like the demographics would do, just take all the Christians and all of its cults all together.
Right.
Would you say it's the successful, most largest legend of all time?
Yeah. Let me answer that. Let me back up a little bit. See, I grew up as a Catholic, and so in my high school years, like your age, I would have been a Catholic. And then in college, I became a born-again believer. And when I became a born-again believer and finding out, wow, this is what the Bible teaches, I'm not a Catholic anymore, because the Catholics believe things contrary to the Bible. And I was kind of like a Baptist kind of person and probably fit in well with the theology of this group. And a lot of the people in that group, they really considered Catholics are not really Christians. I mean, we need to evangelize them and save them. They need to be born again. They're just lost, So then I went to seminary and stuff, then I learned a bigger picture. You can say, like, well, they are Christians, they just have a different way of, it's just a different kind of Christianity. And yes, I don't agree with their theology, but they're part of the bigger Christian group. And I think also when you read Acts, you can see the different kind of Christians. Like, for example, Peter is in Jerusalem in Acts, and he's evidently able to live there okay. And as soon as Paul comes to visit, he's got the reputation of preaching to the Gentiles. As soon as he comes, boom, he's arrested. They don't like this guy. So why is he arrested, but Peter's doing okay? It's because Peter had a very Jewish kind of Christianity, which he followed the Jewish rules and everything. And Paul's the one saying, oh, you don't have to follow all that stuff. So as soon as he comes, boom, the Jews get him. So it kind of shows how there's a lot of different Christian. I mean, so it's kind of interesting to find out, you know, who's a Christian or not. So back to your question, why is Christianity so successful? If you consider Christianity, it's kind of like, how do you define Christianity? Well, let's say, you want to include Mormons in that too?
Yeah, my question is, do you think it's the most successful legend of all times?
Yeah, now when I say legend too, it doesn't mean the whole thing is a built-up legend. I mean, you can have legends built on certain people. Like, for example, the Mormons have legends about Joseph Smith, but it's not the real Joseph Smith. It's a romanticized version. Like, there was some guy there, and he was a liar and a cheat, but they took his writings and they have a really strong devotion. So, is he the strongest? It seems like it is. But, you know, like, it's kind of interesting because you can spin them any way you want to. You can have a different kind of Jesus, a Mormon Jesus or a Catholic Jesus. But overall, yeah, it seems like Jesus has been used very successfully by a lot of different groups. And I think the reason why for that, too, I put on my last page there, it's called memes. You guys heard of genes. You know what? In biology, genes are what evolve and things change based on changing genes. Well, in the same way, in the culture, there's memes. Those are ideas that change. And what happens is religion progressed with humanity. And so at first, as religion was invented by humans, as we came out of, you know, cavemen attitudes, first there was kind of a polytheism, then a monotheism, one God. And then to better things like, you know, forgiveness is good ideals and selfishness, and, you know, putting that onto Jesus later is a good idea, centering all those things on Jesus. And this is something I say that the Christians had to learn too, because, you know, supposedly now you say, of course, Jesus is all about love, you know, but there was a times when, you know, you'd be killed by as a heretic. I mean, if you didn't believe the standard Christian community's beliefs, you'd be killed as a heretic. You know, they wanted to kill Martin Luther and John Calvin and stuff, so these reformers, you know. So I see Jesus being used as, yeah, in cultural evolution. And I think he's probably easy to use too, because it's harder to, since we don't have the originals, it's harder to discredit. Like with Joseph Smith, it's easy to discredit him because he says he translated the Book of Abraham, and he says, look at these pictures, they're Egyptian pictures, and this is what it translates to. And now we can say, oh, now we know for sure that's the picture, that's not what it translates to. But in the Bible, we don't even have the originals. Like I said, when the tombs opened up and the people came out, some people say that must be in the original because we don't find any more earlier copies that don't have that. But then some people say, well, it doesn't make sense, so it had to have been added in there. So, is that a convoluted answer? Did I answer your question? I'll try to answer from another way if I wasn't direct.
That's fine. What's your question, Mrs. Blanchard?
Well, it's on a slightly different trail. So, if you were going to label yourself, I don't know if you're into labeling, because
sure,
nobody is these days, but you say secular humanist.
Yeah.
Do you find that there's a unifying definition? Because on here you said
right,
my definition of it. Do you find there's
right,
like a large group that would agree, yes, this is our definition of secular humanism, or is it something
mm-hmm,
more that just sort of each person that carries that title defines for themselves?
That's a really good question. I was thinking about that on the way over here too. I've been thinking about it for quite some time also. There is a secular humanist community, but it's extremely small, and I would say it's in its infancy still, and I'm not even sure if it's going to grow out of its infancy, and I'll tell you why. Is because, like, when I was a Christian and I left Christianity, it's kind of like, now what am I going to do? And it was very tempting to say, okay, well, now I'm just going to live my life. If I like sports, I'll get into sports. You know, people like poker or stamp collecting or whatever your hobby is, that's what you're going to do. You're not going to say, okay, well, I'm going to start a group and meet with other people to talk about religion. Why would I do that? I would just live my life now, you know? So I think that's a very strong tendency. And one reason why I continue on in apologetics in a different way, I mean, it doesn't bother me to say, like, this is apologetics for secular humanism, is because I have kids, and it's like, well, I might as well teach them what I learned. And it's like, well, if I'm going to teach them, maybe I'll just teach other people, too. And plus, it's good for myself to know why I left, because it's such an important thing. If you're going to leave God, you better have good reasons. You know, I didn't want to leave unless every single possible thread was broken, basically. because I didn't want to leave, you know, God and try to come back later and say, oh, I made a dumb mistake, so I want to be really sure. So anyway, there's some very small groups on secular humanism. Like nationally, there's two main groups, American Humanist Association and Center for Inquiry, and they're both, they don't even have presences in every state, but like in Oregon, we have a presence from each one. But neither one is even mature enough organizational-wise to even have their own building. One of them leases a building, the other one just meets in coffee shops and restaurants. So, you know, compared to the hundreds of churches, there's not one secular humanist organization that has a building. So it's not like, you know, a lot of competition, like people are gonna leave and go to some other building kind of thing. There's a Council for Secular Humanism, and they have a bunch of We Believe statements, and there's kind of a loose fellowship, but this is what I feel the freedom to say, like, this is my definition, and the reason why I like my definition so much is it's very sweet and concise to one sentence, where a lot of the other ones are three or four or five sentences, and so it's not. You know, if secular humanism was more mature, like maybe 100 years from now or 200 years from now, let's say everybody left Christianity and became a secular humanist, I think it would be the same situation where you'd have different denominations, kind of. Like some would be like very anti-religion, some would be very much into feeding starving people, some would be, you know, very much into different aspects of it. And they'd squabble amongst themselves whether they're doing the right thing, just like Christians do now, you know, whether they should be doing this thing or that thing, political or not. You know, those kind of things. So I'd say the movement as an organization is very small. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Do you find that modern science and reason is sufficient for finding truth as, like, would that be the only thing you would say that you would look to for truth, or would there be any other options?
I don't think there's anything else available to us besides scientific evidence and reasoning, especially reasoning, because reasoning means you take the facts of the world and then you try to fit them together to make the best. You have a hypothesis based on the best reading of the facts. That's called parsimony. So if your hypothesis is parsimonious, that means it's in line with the facts. So I think what people should do is say, look at the facts of the world and what makes the best sense. Let's make a hypothesis that makes the best sense of these world, this, you know. So on humans, where did humans come from? There are certain hypotheses out there that, like, for Christians, you have a young earth creationist and an old earth creationist. Both of them reject evolution, and they have different ideas about when humans came on the scene. And then there's some Christians who accept evolution, so they have a different idea too. So should you be a Christian that denies human evolution, or should you be a Christian that accepts evolution, or should you be a non-Christian that accepts evolution? So, you know, they all entail looking at the evidence and using your reason. In no case can I see, I mean, what's the alternative? The alternative to me seems like praying to God for an answer. And it seems to me, when you look at history, the reason why science and technology is growing exponentially, which means it's growing, is kind of feeding on itself on a positive feedback cycle, is because science has been proven to be very successful, and reason, and that's kind of what we've been doing in the last 100 years. And then those who, you know, just go by feelings or revelation, they've been proven, it seems like they're the ones who are proven wrong, like Harold Camping, you know, he just knows for sure in his spirit the end of the world is a certain date because he calculated it, and God's validating it, and then how embarrassing, he's wrong. So it's like, I don't know of anything else besides science and reason that you can use to make a decision. I mean, unless it was feelings, then I would say feelings are is a very bad idea.
So Christian religion is divided, and you make that point well. And then you refer to science as if it were monolithic. Does natural science agree on every evolutionary topic, like the origins of humanity? You describe it in your language as if it's divided Christianity with all these many views, or science on which we can rely. Has scientific inquiry and research changed our minds on different things that we knew were absolutely true in 1950? Mm-hmm. And also presently today, are there opposing views concerning, let's say, the origins of humanity, mm-hmm. or other really important issues to people?
Yeah, that brings up an interesting, very good topic. There's a thing, so some things in science that scientists disagree about, and some things they pretty much agree about. You know, so for example, at one time we thought everything went around the Earth. That's called geocentricity. And that's what the whole scientific establishment thought. And then they, Copernicus and Galileo perfected the telescope more. And so they discovered that, maybe everything goes around the sun instead. So then they came with the heliocentricity. So yeah, science, the establishment changed. They got something new. But keep in mind, it's not just changing. They're never going to change back. So when they're changing to closer and closer to the truth, I think. And then it turns out Galileo was wrong, too, that everything doesn't go around the sun either. We just that's our solar system. But then we have the sun going around the Milky Way, and we have Milky Way, all these other galaxies out there. So we learn all these things, like there's hundreds of billions of stars in the Milky Way galaxy alone, and there's hundreds of billions of galaxies, no doubt. Well, these are things they didn't know back then, and we're not going to go back to the old stuff when they had these ideas either.
So we're getting close to the truth, but we don't have the truth yet.
Right.
Science hasn't delivered to us the truth yet.
Right. So what can we rely on? So we can rely on the facts, and also especially reasoning. That's why I say reasoning is even the most important. There's a thing called...
Just back up, Bernie. What about presently? Are you aware of any substantive differences in the community of natural science among evolutionists, which is 99% of natural science? Are you aware of any substantive differences concerning substantive issues and research and theory concerning the origins of humanity or any other significant issue?
Yeah, so let's talk about how humans arose. Did they come from other animals, or what's the competing hypothesis? The competing hypothesis is that God just made them by a miracle. So there's two hypotheses of how humans hadn't already...
Yeah, but I'm just talking about in science, not on the Christian side. Like,
I'm thinking
of specifically two, right now there are two large schools in natural science that have two very different theories about the origins of humanity. And I can go online and find articles. I can go to the bookstore and find books where they are talking against each other. I was just wondering if you're aware
Do you remember an example off the top of your head?
Well, yeah, there's the out of Africa.
Okay, right.
The paleontologists.
Okay.
Against the new geneticists. And they are not in agreement concerning the origins of humanity.
Yeah. So there's one thing I wanted to say, and I wanted to say before I forget, and then okay, so when it comes to evolution, I see it as in two parts. Okay, one part is the scientists are agreed on one thing, and that is that evolution happened, and so they would say that is a fact. Did humans evolve from animals? Yes, we did. That's a scientific fact. And what is a fact? A fact, Stephen Jay Gould said, I define fact as something that is so obvious that if you reject it, it's like obscene, or it's just super disgusting. So, you know, that's why people argue about what are the facts. And so from my understanding, I'm not going to say natural scientists, I'm going to say all scientists, because there's a lot of believers who are scientists too. I think that almost all of them, like 99% or more, would say that evolution is a fact. Now a separate thing is the mechanism of evolution. How did it happen? And that is what's really being debated in research and trying to figure out. So then the question is, well, how could you say it's a fact if you don't know how it happened exactly? Well, it's the same, well, the thing is, it's because, to give an example, it's kind of like DNA in a murder case. You know, somebody could say, like, I wasn't there at that murder scene at all. And they'll say, well, we have the victim's DNA under your fingernails, and there was finger scratch marks on the victim, and your DNA is, you know, on them. So when you say you're out of town, that doesn't line up. I'm sorry, and you're guilty. So people have been convicted on DNA evidence. How did they kill them? Nobody knows. Nobody saw it. But they know that they did it because they were involved. And the same way, when you look through evolution, you can see the evidence. So that's in logic, that's called abduction. There's like deduction, induction, and there's abduction. Abduction is when you put all the facts together, and so it's the most parsimonious, or parsimonious, they say. So anyway, so I'd say the fact that it happened is what they all agree on. How it happened is what they're trying to discover. There's a lot of weird things that people, that they're trying to figure out. Like Darwin thought, oh, there's random mutation and a natural selection. That's how it happened. And then we learned all these other things since then. Like, there's a thing called human gene transfer, or horizontal gene transfer, which means like viruses could actually come into your, you can catch a virus and it can get embedded in your DNA, and our DNA has like 5% of this, I think, where viruses are in there, and the DNA code got messed around a little bit, and that's where we got some of our DNA to do things. So those are things that Darwin would have never thought about, especially because he didn't know about DNA. So the other thing I want to mention is there's a thing called scientific consensus, which means so whenever there's a thing like a controversial topic like global warming, is there such a thing as human-caused global warming? So then the question is there a scientific consensus on this? And this means look at the experts in the field and do they have an agreement or 80%? And so I don't know much about that, but from what I heard people say, claim there is a scientific consensus on that there is human-made caused global warming. And some people don't like the idea of it, so they'll pick their favorite scientist to back them up.
Right.
But some people say it's generally very smart to go with the scientific consensus, because the scientifics, they're the ones trained in it, and if they can come to a consensus, it'd be smartest to go with them instead of somebody else that just, what do you know about the science? Why would you go with some oddball out, you know? But it could be sometimes the oddballs are right, so.
So do you think in the same vein, then, do you think that it would be best for those of us who are not experts in the field of the preservation of ancient documents and the interpretation of ancient languages, let alone translating them, to leave that to the experts in that field?
Well, it's never leave it to them. It's kind of like if you're not going to ever study it yourself, then you're stuck with It's good to look at the experts and try to find out who the experts are. But the best thing to do is, especially if it's something important, is to try to invest your own time to see what their arguments are.
Right.
Because sometimes a Mormon will say, talk to the Mormon experts about Mormonism. If you want to learn about Mormonism, who's a Mormon expert? Or a seminary professor is like,
right.
Not necessarily. You might want to talk to somebody who totally has the opposite opinion like you and see what you have to say about Mormonism. So that's part of critical thinking, as you
right.
look at the critics and to get a good idea. So.
Right. Good. Questions. Get them out there.
I do, but I feel bad because this is not technically my class. But I have a question from something. So when I was growing up, I was in this Baptist church or whatever, and I remember this poster, and it had like these two castles, and one was, I'm sorry to say, the Secular Humanist castle, and there was probably like a dark cloud over them. And at the foundation of theirs, it said evolution. It had a castle, and then it had all these balloons, and it was like homosexuality, abortion, and I don't remember what other
right.
things like that.
Right.
And then it had like the Christian castle, and at the foundation of theirs was creation. And then it had like our balloons, which would have been, I don't know, what would our balloons have been?
That was an ICR poster.
Okay.
Institute for Creation Research.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of, like Kim
yeah.
Ham, Masses and Genesis.
Yeah,
so then it had all the
things that we would, whatever, the pro-life and then the other mm-hmm. issues that we would agree with. And then so the secular humanists had their canons
right.
pointing at creation.
Okay.
And our canons were pointed at their balloons, rather ignoring evolution. Just from your perspective, do you feel like evolution is sort of the rock that you, like if, and I know you don't think this is possible, but if there was some way that we could say, oh, actually it didn't happen, like would that sort of crumble?
Oh yeah.
Not saying that creation did happen, but just if we could say something came up to say evolution, no.
Right.
Would secular humanism crumble?
Yeah, two things on that. When I say this, I'm kind of afraid I'm going to lose the other one, so I'm trying to get them both out there quickly. But, okay, the first thing is, as an atheist, and this is one reason that I was able to leave Christianity, is because evolution is a whole alternative way of looking at the whole world, how everything is about evolution. even a lot of atheists don't know this, but you know, atheists say, oh, evolution, that's just biological evolution. There's so much more than biological evolution. There's also cosmological evolution. That's actually a term. A lot of atheists aren't even educated in this. How did the sun get to where it came? That's a cosmological evolutional question. You know, what happened since the Big Bang exploded? How did we get all these chemicals? You know, did things start off with, like, I think, is it helium or hydrogen is the first element?
Hydrogen.
Okay, and then hydrogen turns into helium in the furnace of these stars, and the stars blow up and create all these heavier elements.
Yeah.
This is cosmological evolution. Then there's biological evolution, and now Richard Dawkins has a new thing called mimetic evolution for how thoughts evolve and culture. Why do we have religion? It's because of social evolution. And where's the evolution going? Survival of the fittest. Whatever's true is really going to win because it's more powerful. And that's why I think Christianity's going to go down intellectually. You know, there's still going to be always the mystics who are saying, I don't use my brain. I just have a devotion to Jesus. That's it. So don't talk to me about arguments, you know. There's always going to be people who are just religious like that, but I think the intellectual part's going to go down, and all the intellectual religion part is going to go to a naturalistic viewpoint. So your question was, so I'm trying to say yes, it's extremely important about evolution. Oh, here's the second point, is that that's a big, see, that was put out by a young earth creationist group that does, they're very literal about creation. They say everything flows from creation, which has some truth, but one thing they're not saying and admitting is there's a lot of Christians who accept evolution now. And I believe there's actually a crisis now. When you look at the academics, the seminary professors, and the scientists who are Christians, there's a crisis because a lot of them accept evolution, but it hasn't gotten down to the church level and the pastor level yet. And so it's like, how do you tell the church and the pastors that evolution is something we should accept as Christians? And so there's kind of a rupture now, because there's certain Christians like Francis Collins, you may have heard of, you know, he's trying to tell his fellow Christians, like, there's evidence for evolution, and it shouldn't be a threat to your religion. So don't feel the threat so much. And the young earthers, they're the ones who are saying, like, oh, Francis Collins, he's going to destroy our faith, because once you accept evolution, you're going to become an atheist. Well, I actually believe that, but still, I think you have to accept evolution, because it's true, so.
Do you think there's any possibility for evolution and Christianity to be... You think the existence of evolution would have to disprove the existence of God?
Yeah, that's my conclusion. That's why I left the faith, but I'm actually developing that thesis and giving some presentations out in the Portland area on that, and I'm looking forward to having some other professors and stuff engage me, and Pastor Nathan's going to be one of the people on a subset of that. I'm talking about neurology and how that impacts the idea of the soul, and that's what we're going to talk about next time at church. I think it's the 18th of March.
Yeah, it's coming up. It's next Sunday night.
So,
the human soul, does it exist? Bernie thinks that it's neurological, and I think it's spiritual, the soul. So we're going to talk about that. We have time for another question or two or three. What's your question? If you haven't asked a question yet, ask one. Go ahead, Christina.
Well, you talked about how Christians being divided on their beliefs kind of, well, it's a big argument against Christianity because all the Christians are so divided on who they think Jesus is. But if our ultimate source of truth is reasoning, of course we're all going to reason in different ways. Nobody's reasoning is exactly the same as someone else's. So it'd be logical that different people would have different opinions on who Christ is, and similarly, evolutionists all have different theories. They don't agree on something, but we all agree that there was Christ. I mean, so we all have that foundation, just like you were talking about, that the secular humanists all believe in evolution, even though they don't know exactly how it came about. They differ in that. So why does the fact that we differ, why is that like a bullet against us, whereas the evolutionists differing on how evolution came about?
Well, I'm not sure. My point wasn't that because Christians differ, that's a That's, I was just trying to tell you that's a state of things. I'm not trying to say that's really evidence that it's wrong.
Oh, okay.
Like I said, for example, if secular humanism ever blossomed and grew up, and a whole bunch of people were secular humanists, we would also have different groups. Like some would say, you know, we should do this in politics. Some would say no politics at all.
Mm-hmm.
So if our groups were bigger, I think we would also have our different factions. But when it comes to understanding Jesus, you know, at some point you have to say, is this a different Jesus or not? It's just
mm-hmm.
like, Christians and Muslims will argue, do we believe in the same God? Some people say, obviously it's not the same God because your God says to kill people or whatever, all these different things, and our God doesn't do that. But then some people will say, well, there's only one God, it's just that you don't know him correctly,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
And we both believe in one God. And then Muslims will say, well, we don't believe in this Trinity thing, it's totally convoluted. So at some point you have to say, like, are these Jesuses the same or not? I mean, and when you look at Catholics and Protestants, there's radical things like Catholics believe if you miss Mass to go to this church instead on a Sunday, and you know the catechisms, that they have what they call a church, that's an obligation to attend church. So if you know that rule in the catechism and you go to this church instead, that's called a mortal sin. And if you don't get forgiveness for that, you're going to hell. You know, a lot of Catholics don't even know that. And if you receive communion in the Catholic Church and you're in this fallen state, that's another like mortal sin kind of thing. So you're not supposed to take communion again until you go to the father, the priest, and get, you know, confession and
mm-hmm.
all this stuff. And so you guys don't obviously believe if you miss church one Sunday you're going to hell. Of course not, because you have
I'm working on it.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
I'm trying to get that rule in our catechism.
So. You know, and like I said, they believe that that's literally Jesus. Like if you spilled some, you know, if they're taking wine, that's the blood of Jesus,
yeah.
Literally. If you drop down the carpet, oh my gosh, what do? We have a scandal here. We have the blood of Jesus on the carpet. Seriously, this is not just wine. What do? I mean, there's a lot of problems like that. So then they say things like, oh, well, actually, if you just take the host only, the bread, that's like the bread and the wine combined. It's the same. We'll call that the same, you know. It's like, well, how'd they come up with that?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because why do they even believe it's really the body and blood of Jesus? Because Jesus said it. This is my body and this is my blood. Okay, but then the church says, oh, but if you just take the bread only, that's like taking both. So, you know, it's kind of funny how they choose where to go, literal or not.
Her question does point to, I mean, you've made a good demonstration of how feelings aren't reliable, but neither is reason necessarily reliable. I mean, we can disagree on feelings and we can disagree on reason. So it kind of suggests that we need something more reliable, something more set in stone.
Like what, though?
Like the Bible?
The Bible interpreted it. So, I mean,
well,
how do you interpret the Bible? Through logic?
Right.
Right,
is,
so you're back to reason again.
That.
So you're back to reason.
Yeah, as unreliable, though, I think her point, she has a good point, because reason is not above human interpretation. That's the problem we keep bumping up against in this class, is that if there are human beings involved, there's going to be differing opinions and there's going to be a lot of mistakes made. So we're on a discovery toward truth, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah. Hey, what was your question?
But let me say
that
I agree with you. You should look at the Bible. I didn't say don't look at the Bible. Look at the Bible. And how do you know if it's right or not? Look at the Bible, look at science, look at everything. Talk to people, look at logic and philosophy, and then try to sort it out and make the best sense. So I'm not saying don't look at the Bible. I'm saying look at the Bible and try to make sense of it using reason. What else can you use if you don't use reason? The only other possibility I could see is feelings. I'm saying super mistake to use feelings. So.
Well, what is the third alternative that we would believe in that Bernie doesn't believe in?
Well, the Holy Spirit helping
right.
us to interpret, you know, maybe using through our reason. And that doesn't mean we're always going to get it right, but we'll. We pray before we read the
mm-hmm.
scriptures that the Holy Spirit will help us to understand correctly.
Right.
So I guess that's the important alternative, so trusting God, not ourselves. So
yeah,
I guess the opposite
yeah,
of humanism.
And that places it in our class text, John Frame's book. That's why the doctrine of the Holy Spirit is so important to him, because he, as an apologist, has come up against this. And, you know, reason, I mean, we agree. I think we have a lot of agreement in the room about feelings being unreliable. I think that I would be willing to say that reason over several centuries, it seems to me historically, that it takes about 300 years for human reason to actually produce something of large consensus.
Okay, well, here's the point of disagreement I have, though, is that it wouldn't bother me to say if you want to pray to God to have him guide you in the right way. But if somebody were to say, I prayed to God, and I know this is right because I have a feeling, so that's why I say that feeling
right
is unreliable, and don't attribute that to God, because other people are doing the same thing, like Mormonism. They know the Book of Mormon is true because they prayed for God to give them a sign, and God gave them a sign. I debated with Mormons before, and they challenged me to take that test, and I did. I prayed about the Book of Mormon, and I got a feeling. And then when I got the feeling, my mind said, what are you doing? You can't believe this stuff because of what you know. It's like, you're right. So it's like my brain saved me mm-hmm. from my feelings. And so when those Mormons say, like, oh, I just love this so much because I feel it, I know what they're talking about because I felt it too.
Yeah. Okay, Danielle, you get the last question.
All right. Well, the first question we had, Christina asked you about scriptures, and you said they're hardly accurate. So if we say they're hardly accurate, I'm just a little bit confused how we can use them to disprove Christ if they're inaccurate.
Well, one reason why I think they're inaccurate is because of contradictions and things that don't add up, I would say. Why do... I'm not saying it's inaccurate just because I don't want it to be true, so I say it's inaccurate. That's not the way it is. The reason why I'm saying it's inaccurate is I think it's because of inconsistencies and things I see in there.
So you think the origin of species has a lot of inaccuracies in it? I mean, Darwin did the best he could in the day that he did.
Yeah, you
so
know what?
Would you say they're just it's unusable anymore? It's unreliable.
Oh no, I'm not saying the Bible is totally unusable. There's some good things in the Bible. There's some really good things in there that are taught, but there's also some really bad things, I would say. Like, for example, Jesus saying, turn the other cheek to your enemy. I think that's very bad, actually.
Okay.
I think you should protect yourself and defend yourself, and that passage, I think, teaches against it. And so, as a Christian, I tried to follow that as bad advice, and after I left, it's like, geez.
That's how you got that big scar on your cheek?
Yeah. No.
Okay, thank you, Bernie.
All right.